However, I was introduced, thank you for that, as a university professor, which I am, but basically I am a human fellow being and a brother in Christ. So that is my basic identity. I'll just share with you one passage from the Romans 13:8. Owe no man anything but to love one another, for he that loveth one another hath fulfilled the law. Now you can clearly hear that this is from an old verse in the New Testament. But the meaning is the same. It's all about love. It's the most difficult word to define, I suppose. And I would have liked very much to sit down together with you and discuss this. Pose the question to you, what is love? What do you understand by love? What's the essence of love? And then you would ask me, well, what kind of love are you thinking of? Well, I'm thinking of that kind of love, which we read of in the Bible. I will give you one definition. It's my own. It's homemade, so to say. Love is warm, wide, working will to the well-being of your neighbor for here and now and for eternity. Did you get that? You noticed the alliteration. That's an old Norwegian custom to make these kind of alliterations. I'll repeat it. But you will not have this as your homework, though. Love is warm, wide, working will for the well being. I don't like the word welfare, but well-being of your neighbor here and now and for eternity. Oh, those were words. Love has something to do with words. It has something to do with passionate words spoken by a husband to his wife. Love includes what you are often thinking of, sexual relationships. It includes that. I ought to know, because I've been happily married for 40 years, mind you, with the same darling of mine. So that's included. Very much so, but love is much more. Love is to, well, faith is to receive. Isn't that right? That's true. Faith is to receive, and love is to give. But there is a secret about that. Love is also to receive. If you do not have the humbleness to receive, you do not really love. And then, I will finish this by trying to illustrate this. I'm a university professor, it was said, truly so, but I am basically a Christian and a minister of the church. The Church Universal in Castle, the Church of Norway. And when I ask to perform wedding ceremonies, I do so if I think it's right. And when I'm asked to perform funeral services, I can hardly refuse to do so. And once, very recently, I did so. One of my neighbors had lost his wife, beloved wife, and after the funeral service, we were together for a gathering in the home. And when I should say goodbye, the granddaughter of the deceased lady, came up to me to give me a big hug, which I accepted with great pleasure. And then she asked me, could you, 9 years old, could I ask you something about Christianity? For sure, I said, sure, of course you can. And then she posed this question, why had Jesus to die for us? It's very surprised. You reflect a little bit on that. Has that something to do with love? Well, an illustration. During the Second World War, there lived in Poland a certain priest, Roman Catholic priest, by the name of Maximilian Kolbe. Kolbe, you would say. He was taken prison and sent to the terrible concentration camp of Auschwitz, together with thousands of others. And when this little girl asked me the simple question, why had Jesus to die for us, I asked, have you ever heard of Auschwitz, the concentration camp? And to my surprise, she had heard about it. And I told about this pastor who was imprisoned there. And one day, it was not a rare experience to that concentration camp, several names were read loudly. Those were the ones who were going to be executed that day, or that week it was. And among these who were condemned to death was one family father, who was very upset about it. Well, who wouldn't be? But he was so upset because it was a family father who was going to take care of his children. And Kolbe heard about that and he said, well, I'll go in your stead, in your place. I will go instead of you. And very, very strange it was that the authorities of the concentration camp permitted that. They accepted it. So Maximilian Kolbe just was very slowly put to death instead of another one. And that was what I told this little girl. I didn't speak to her about sin, a 9 years old little girl. And I did not do that to you either. The Holy Spirit will take over that job for me. But I will remind you that love is what Jesus did for us, and it is played out in everyday life. Words we say to those we have some kind of responsibility for, and words we do not say, angry words we do not say. It's a basic attitude. Love is a basic attitude. And I will ask you to join me in a brief prayer. And we cannot pray to you, Lord, without thanking you for that unique demonstration of love you gave for the entire world, dying for us, rising again for us, living for us, being with us today, here and now. And we beseech you, Lord, will you teach us this love in everyday life? Teach you that love of gratitude towards you and towards each other. Thank you, Lord. Amen.
blessing is the same tune and everything as the invocation was. We'll skip the next song because it's beginning.
Can
we
do it?
Okay.
Gotta do it.
Brothers and sisters, let us pray. All blessings flow from you, O Lord, and we raise our hearts in praise and thanksgiving today. Lead us, we pray, in our study, in our work, in our loves, in our families. Through Christ our Lord. Of the day of St. Matthew, but not as a basis for my meditation, I read to you these verses from Matthew chapter 9. As he passed on from there, Jesus saw a man named Matthew at his seat in the custom house and said to him, "Follow me." And Matthew rose and followed him. When Jesus was at table in the house, many bad characters, tax gatherers and others, were seated with him and his disciples. The Pharisees noticed this and said to his disciples, "Why is it that your master eats with tax gatherers and sinners?" Jesus heard it and said, "It is not the healthy that need a doctor, but the sick. Go and learn what that text means. I require mercy, not sacrifice. I did not come to invite virtuous people, but sinners. Most of us who enter a college experience come with some degree of anxiety, partly because we are sinners who have been called into a life of faith by Jesus Christ. We're entering a stage of life, most of us, when we arrive at this place where some of the major life decisions will be made. We will be probably choosing a spouse soon. We will probably be choosing an occupation soon. But another underlying factor, and perhaps even more important than these, is more or less on our minds, namely that we will be choosing a faith to live by. We will be in that transition from a childhood faith to an adult faith. And that can be scary. It means leaving some things behind and going to places we have never known before. Our learning may affect that growth and change, and it can be painful. I hope that in any subject you study at Augsburg, you may find your professor relating the learning in that field to questions of Christian faith and Christian life. Perhaps in the religion department, you may encounter new ideas about biblical authorship, for example. Suddenly your lecturer will be talking about J, E, D, and P, or you'll be involved in the synoptic problem. And you'll wonder, why didn't my preacher at home ever tell me about this? Is this some nasty secret that the adults have been keeping away from me all these years? And does this mean that the rug is being pulled out from underneath my faith in Jesus Christ? It doesn't need to be. Part of growing and stretching spiritually also may involve doubting. Doubting has more than one aspect, however, and there's more than one kind of doubting. There's a kind of intellectual doubting. We want to encourage people in a liberal arts college to do a lot of intellectual doubting. Not to take things for granted. To investigate the truth, to question. When it comes to matters of Christian faith, there is also another kind of doubting, which I would call behavioral doubting. This isn't just an intellectual curiosity or uncertainty. This is a shaking of one's life values, testing, trying out varieties and new ways of living. If you are going to grow into a mature Christian, you will have to grow out of your childhood life of worship and prayer and into an adult practice of these Christian disciplines. Worship goes beyond the specific hours set aside for it, of course. We are called to worship in the library and in the laboratory, as well as in the worship gathering. But today I'd like to call your attention to a helpful insight from one Charles Olson that can help you, I hope, as it has helped me to see, a way of growing through and into the transition of adult responsibility for worship and prayer, which is an essential part of going through the experience of doubt and stretching and struggling, which I faced very much when I was a student here, in which I expect many of you are also facing right now. This insight is this, that our worship life is like a three-legged stool. Each leg may be short or long, and we may be out of balance if they are. There are three forms of worship that are represented by these three legs. One is the worship of solitude. Another another is the worship in the face-to-face fellowship group. And the third is the worship of the congregation. Many of you who are here have been disappointed in congregational worship. You have gone feeling lonely, sometimes in despair. You have gone and sat next to strange people in a large auditorium, gone through a fixed liturgy, if you're a Lutheran or a Catholic, and left feeling that your needs have not been met. Perhaps the point is that each of these forms of worship has its own specific strengths, and it meets our needs at particular areas, and we should not expect each type to meet all of our needs. The special contribution of the public worship is to broaden our horizons, to get us out of introspection and even out of the day-by-day concerns of our personal relationships, and to open our horizons, to open our horizons, to widen our scope, both in time and space, to the whole story of Christian redemption, going way back there from Abraham and beyond him to the creation and forward to that consummation that we look forward to. And also in space, to realize that we're not the only people who have not bowed the knee to Baal, but that there are Christian brothers and sisters all over the world. The function, then, of the public worship is maybe not to develop an intimate relationship with fellow believers, but rather to keep us on course by giving us the broader perspective. Many of you have participated in congregational worship, however, and have found that not adequate to meet what you really need as a Christian. I believe that Olson is right when he says we also need the face-to-face fellowship group. There are all sorts of support groups going around in the world today for various causes. I think that followers of Jesus also need one another's support. It's in that group that your own needs, promises, can be addressed honestly. There is where you can perhaps most honestly hug your neighbor. The fellowship group might be of various sizes, even just the two. But somewhere along the line, you need someone who can encourage you, who can understand you, and when necessary, rebuke you as a brother or sister in Christ. Finally, there is the third leg of the stool, that is the solitude type of worship. Very difficult for those of us who are Americans and are used to something happening every minute. We need time of quietness to get perspective on our inner life. To do, as the song suggested, to surrender ourselves to God day by day. And say very simply to Him, Father, I adore you. I lay my life before you. These three types of worship work together. They all supplement and feed one another. And none of the three all alone can meet our needs for worship and prayer in this time of crisis in our lives when we are in transition from childhood to adult worship and faith. I urge you to attend a congregation. You've heard two outstanding pastors speak to you in chapel. Pastors from Trinity and Bethel. I urge you not to fall back into simply personal or small group types of worship, but to participate in the public worship as well. Churches with walls also have value, even though the real church is in your heart and mine, where the Holy Spirit dwells and moves. Praise be to His name. Let us sing.
We're going to try something here as we sing Built on a Rock. Everybody will sing stanzas 1, 4, and 5. Everybody that has a shoe size smaller, let's say larger than 9 on stanza 2, and 9 or under stanza
YE team, sponsored by Lisbon Youth Encounter, and they're really good. I've heard just great things about them. I, you know, want to encourage you all to come. It'll be up here in the Commons at 7 o'clock on Tuesday, October 2nd.
This Saturday, there's an exciting event taking place called Hope for Hungry People, and it's a workshop about hunger. It's going to take place from 9:30 to 4 p.m. at Concordia College campus in St. Paul. And there's going to be a variety of events going on, from bluegrass music to street breakers, English folk dancers, a Baroque jazz quartet, Chimera Theater's Annie. There'll be Hmong handicrafts and a Jubilee crafts workshop, and items for sale. You will be able to buy lunch there. They'll have sandwiches and deli foods. And then there'll be several learning forums taking place in the afternoon. One on lifestyle, alternative lifestyles, several dealing with hunger, the disappearance of the family farm, a workshop on liturgical dance and the art of clowning. And you can take part in one or two of the learning forums. And then to end the day at 3 o'clock, there'll be an ecumenical worship service. And Dr. Arthur Simon, who is the founder and well, he's like the organizer or the director of Bread for the World. He'll be speaking at that. So the cost for the event is $2. So it's very reasonable. A lot of people have been working hard on it, and it should be really good. And if students are interested in going, maybe we could carpool and leave from campus at 9:15 on Saturday morning. Leave at 9:15. So if you'd like to meet in the Mort Ernest lobby, anyone that can drive, come, and anyone interested in going, we can meet and then plan to come back immediately afterwards.
We're really pleased to have Sue here, Sue Pearson, as resident head at Mortensen. She's got some great ideas, and you'll be hearing some of them as time goes on. We begin our worship in the name of God, our Creator, our Redeemer, and our Sanctifier. Amen. Our prayer this morning is by Becky White.
Please pray with me. Lord God, we thank you for bringing John Luisakav to Augsburg again. We thank you for the many gifts and talents you have given him. We thank you for his willingness to share those talents with us. We ask that you bless and guide him in his ministry, especially today as he leads us in worship. Lord, in this broken and hurting world, we pray for your healing. Equip us as your servants to minister to the needs of our neighbors, to spread hope and love throughout the world. We ask that you place your healing hand on Herb Brokering as he recovers from his heart surgery. And we ask that you be with Lisa Woodruff's sister, who is not well. Continue to watch over Michael Bilde as he is very sick, and be with his family as they continue to deal with the stress of his illness. And again, Lord, we ask you to be with Hawa in her time of struggling with grief. Strengthen her and let her know that she isn't alone in this. Lord, we thank you for your faithfulness to us. We ask that you would guide us and keep us always in your truth. In the name of Jesus Christ, we ask all of this. Amen.
Ago or so, I met a man by the name of John Fisher, and he was signing up with a record company which was just in the process of being formulated, called FEL, or the Friends of the English Liturgy. Some of you may recall this organization, which operated out of Chicago. And I was sort of embryonic in this business, and he certainly was. And then I signed a record company out of New York called Vanguard, or Avant-Garde label. And I bought all his records. I assume he bought all of mine. Well, since then, he sort of made a name for himself because he writes a column for a periodical called Contemporary Christian Magazine. Some of you may be familiar with it. It's called Sound Advice. It's a very good column. I try to read it all the time. Hoel this summer. He came out with a very interesting article. It's called What Are We Waiting For? And I'd like to read a bit of it before we get into some music here. The extent of my rebellion in high school was a 5-minute reversible customizing job on the family car. Whenever I had it for the evening, I would stop a block away from home, remove the grill work around the taillights and any chrome I could take off with a screwdriver. Then I would reset the buttons on the radio, keep the automatic transmission in low, and always encouraged my dad not to fix the muffler. Now, for Southern California, 20 years ago, that was extremely mild hot sauce. But from a church kid who always kept his nose clean, it was about the most you could expect. For me, and in some ways for all of us, contemporary Christian music began in that car. It was a warm night, and I had been to church enjoying my friends. I remember feeling particularly close to God when I got in the car and started up the engine to drive home. As I turned the key, the radio blared right where I had left it, and the energy of Beatlemania filled the car. My first impression was slight embarrassment. God was certainly not interested in listening to this. But as I reached to turn off the radio, God had a surprise for me. The closest I can come to expressing what happened in that instant would be for you to imagine God appearing next to me in the car as George Burns. He says, "Wait a minute, kid. Leave it on. You know, I kind of like this stuff." I watched in shock as he smiled at me through a casual puff of cigar smoke, and I swayed his head ever so slightly with the music. "She loves you, yeah." He leaned toward me so that he could speak more carefully and still be heard over the music. "Do you really think all I want to hear are funeral dirges? Really? Who made this music in the first place? Who gave these guys the ability to do what they do? Look, kid, if four mop heads from Liverpool can capture the world for their own glory and a good time, imagine what you can do. Think about it." Then he vanished. I drove home half crying, half laughing, knowing my life and my future would be greatly affected by that moment in my dad's 57 Ford. Well, right now we're caught in a classic adolescent identity crisis. Who are we? Are we artists or preachers when we perform? Is it a concert or is it church? Are Christian recording companies businesses or ministries? Are we singing to Christians or non-Christians? Is our music sacred or secular? Are we entertainers or evangelists? No one seems to be able to answer these questions, and the resulting confusion leaves us frantically trying to fulfill a host of varying expectations that have arisen amidst the Christian subculture. When you don't know who you are, you let those around you dictate it, and you end up customizing your Ford over and over again. And what he means is that it's definitely a business. And ABC owns Word in Waco, and they run it very much like a business. Well, he says, we're losing authenticity. The baton of authenticity, which we carried through the disillusionment of the 70s, is being passed to a generation of new wavers, a generation of young people who don't know the labels and don't really care. They only care whether you mean what you say and say it with everything you've got. Well, the cycle of history has brought us in some ways back to the 60s. Commitment to certain ideals and fervor are back in secular music, and the world is playing music from the heart again, while most Christians are caught in a stagnant cycle of spiritual cliches. Now, about 8 or 9 years ago, we used to get complimentary albums from all of these companies. At that time, there were many more little record companies. Now they're pretty much under two umbrellas, the Benson Company in Nashville and Word. And, we were just inundated. We had no room to keep it. I had no time really to listen to all of it. And when I did listen to some of it, I was pretty depressed. And so we just finally called them all up and told them to stop, turn it off. And they did. Well, so I really didn't listen to a lot of that music for a while. And then he says, but It was because it was they were living in a kind of an almost adolescent, really an adolescent era. And he said it's not that bad. It's a time of energy, discovery, and freedom. It's full of potential, a time of playing with possibilities. But sooner or later, one must grow up. Adulthood is a time of decision, responsibility, action. Finally, after trying all the avenues, one must make a choice and put all his or her energies behind that choice. So he said it's time for the contemporary musicians to enter adulthood. And God has placed in our hearts the words and the feelings, whether or not we can make a living with it. And so I decided to check it out again. So I went over to the Northwestern bookstore. And I was in for a mild surprise. And kind of sense what's going to happen here. I was also working on a show for Scan about the political, fundamentalist political right-wing organizations. So the two kind of came together. First we'll do a song by a group called Prodigal, which you can see the album here. Reasonably new slices. I thought it, you can sing any time you want to just jump in with us, okay? You probably can do it as well as me. I thought it was so easy when I met you, when I let you touch me, I thought my pain was through. I guess I was mistaken. I didn't realize that I might see things different if I saw them through your eyes. You drive a hard bargain, the only one around. You drive a hard bargain, the only one I found. You drive a hard bargain, but the other kind of life is just no bargain at all. At times I feel so old for all that I've been through, but I know you don't change. Still a child to you. I guess I've got to grow up before we grow apart. No time like the present to let the healing start. You drive a hard bargain. You drive a hard bargain, the only one I've found. You drive a hard bargain, but the other kind of life is just no bargain at all. No bargain at all. No bargain at all. You hold an image, it provides a common thread. No sense of menace, no feeling of dread. You never worry your pretty little head. And angels tuck you in tonight. Angels tuck you in tonight. Angels tuck you in and greet you in the morning light. And you can sing that part, the part that's capital. The angels tuck you in tonight. Angels tuck you in tonight. Angels tuck you in and greet you in the morning light. This cartoon world we've created, it's like Disneyland. Get out your gold.
suffering for the chosen few. And angels tuck you in tonight. Angels tuck you in tonight. And angels tuck you in and greet you in the morning light. You've been a wide-eyed innocent. Come to the garden, come to the hill, come to the tree, come to the kill. Won't break your legs, but it can break your will. You're too afraid of hurting. Been playing cover up. Expose yourself to dying. And in this real world, it is your calling. You hold it image, it provides a common thread. No sense of menace, no feeling of dread. You never worry a pretty little head. And angels tuck you in tonight. Angels tuck you in tonight. Angels tuck you in and greet you in the morning light.
That's Daniel Amos, and there's a series of albums that they're putting out called the Alarma Chronicles, Volume 2. Okay. Steve Taylor, whom you may have seen on MTV if you watch such, is a Meltdown is the song, it's the album title, has written this song. Okay. You have to remember these are all from a Christian record company now. So you need a new car, let your fingers take a walk through the business guide for the born again flock. You'll be keeping all your money now, and you'll only drink milk from a Christian cow. Don't go casting your bread to keep the heathen well fed. Find Christian pockets instead. Avoid temptation, guilty by association. Turn the radio on. A down-home drawl. Hear a Bill Green prophet with a bad message for y'all. I found a new utensil in the devil's toolbox, and the heads are gonna roll if Jesus rocks. It's a worldly design. God's music should be divine. Try buying records like mine. Avoid temptation. Guilty by association. It's a telephone Tuesday for the Gospel Club. Send your money in now or they're going to pull the plug. Just remember this fact when they bleed and beg. If the chicken squawks loud, it's going to lay a big egg. You could be milling the crook. You should be checking the book. You'd rather listen than look. The implication, guilty by association. It's hard to do this without an eight-piece band, but you have to kind of use your imagination. Bruce Coburn is definitely not possible to do without more accompaniment, but the song, the album is called The Trouble with Normal, and that's not a school in Illinois. Strikes against the frontier and strikes for higher wage. Planet lurches to the right as ideologies engage. Suddenly it's repression, moratorium on rights. What did they think the politics of panic would invite? Person in the street shrugs, security comes first. But the trouble with normal is it always gets worse. Callous men in business costumes speak computerese, play pinball with the third world trying to keep it on its knees. Their single crop starvation plans put sugar in your tea, and the local third world's kept on reservations you don't see. all go back to normal if we put our nation first. But the trouble with normal is it always gets worse and so forth. I'm going to check that out. But there's another song which Bruce wrote a bit ago that I know that I can perform more adequately. And you have a part which goes, ah ha ha. It's called Laughter. Ah ha ha ha. Whoa, whoa, whoa. Ah, ha, ha, ha. Are you ready to try that? Ah, ha, ha, ha. Ah, ha, ha, ha. Oh, 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 oh. Ah, ha, ha, ha. You can even harmonize on it. I laugh for the way my life is gone. I laugh for the love of a friend. I laugh for the fools in the eyes of the world, a love that will never end. Ah, ah, ah. Ah, 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 ah. Oh, 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 oh. Ah, 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 ah. I laugh, let's hear a laugh for the man of the world who thinks he can make things work. Tried to build a new Jerusalem and ended up with New York. Ah, ah, ah. Ah, 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 ah. Oh, 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 oh. Ah, 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 ah. I laugh for the sun red falling through the thermal inversion haze. I laugh for the nuclear good time boys, the numbering all our days. Ah, ah, ah. Ah, 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 ah. Oh, 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 oh. Ah, ah, ah. I laugh for the news friend's nightmare, a world that never was, where the questions are all why and the answers are all because. Oh, oh, oh. Can't hear you now. Ah, 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 ah. Oh, 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 oh. Ah, 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 ah. Tapping our feet to an ancient tomb, I laugh for the time gone by. I laugh for me and Mandy in the delivery room, just waiting for the child's first cry. Ah, ha, ha. Ah, ha, ha, ha. Oh, 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 oh. Ah, ha, ha, ha.
Two announcements. Tonight, John will be here for Eucharist. I would encourage all of you to be here and bring a friend. It's going to be a service of scripture and good, solid Christian songs, right? Mostly written by John. And Terry asked me to remind you that on KCMR, they have a program, She and Patty, 5 o'clock today, tonight, if you want to hear other Christian contemporary gospel music. Shall we stand and receive the benediction? The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift the light of his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen. Go in peace and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.